In this part, we're going to look at the amplifier layout. Here is the layout of our amplifier in 2D, so I've got away from that 3D view. So what do we have here? Here is our transistor, there is the screw connection, here is the gate side of the transistor, and here is the output. Remember that the input of our transistor looks pretty much like 50 ohms, so across here we have a 50 ohm line. There's a DC blocking capacitor. At the output, the main part of the output, is an impedance transformer that tries to go from that 2.5 ohm output resistance of our transistor over to a 50 ohm line. So this is a 50 ohm line here, and that's a DC blocking capacitor. Now I'm going to talk about each of those matching networks individually. Here is our input matching network with some detail. Here is our 50 ohm line. So over here we have a gate connection, and the gate looks very much like 50 ohms in parallel with a small capacitance. So this is a 50 ohm line. This is our DC blocking capacitor. This is the connection to the RF input, which is 50 ohms. Now some of the interesting things here are that we have lots of ground plane. We keep ground everywhere. There's no need to remove metal if we don't have to. So we have ground connection down here, and there are multiple vias to the backing substrate, which is attached to our metal carrier. There are multiple vias here, and here is a ground plane cut off a little bit, but there are multiple vias here as well. We apply gate bias, so we will have multiple bond wires coming across to our gate. Our gate, remember, our gate bias is around about minus 1 volt, but the current is really quite small. One of the key ideas here, and this is common with a lot of input matching network designs, is the use of this 500 ohm resistor here. So that 500 ohm resistor acts as an RF block. So we have a 50 ohm line, and if this resistor is about 10 times that 50 ohm, then it pretty much looks like an RF open circuit. There is very little DC current, so there's very little DC voltage across this resistor. Well, here is our mounting pad, which looks like a little bit of transmission line. And here is an RF transmission line, which is about lambda on 4 long at our operating frequency. It is very narrow, so it is fairly high impedance. We see some miter connections here. And so we're going along here, this transmission line, which is a quarter wavelength long, and then we're hitting a bank of capacitors. We do not use a single capacitor. We use a bank of capacitors, with the first capacitor being rather small so that the parasitic series inductance is also small. So this provides a good RF short circuit. And then this is a slightly larger capacitance, and again, a very large capacitance. We want that capacitance to isolate noise that's on the gate bias circuit from our transistor. We want this to be fairly good DC short for noise on our signal. Now, at RF, this looks like an RF short circuit. In fact, we want to refer our RF short circuit to this point here. And then we go through this lambda on 4 circuit, so we apply an RF open circuit here to provide just that little bit more RF isolation. And to put these capacitors fairly close to each other, we're going to include these capacitors and their distributed nature in a microwave circuit simulation. Now, when we do a design, we're not going to be using EM analysis here. At 3 to 4 GHz, 3.4 to 3.8 GHz, we don't really need to use EM analysis unless it is clear that there is some high-level coupling. Our RF signal here does not have that high-level coupling. Yes, certainly this line and this ground plane are reasonably close, and we could get a better result if we do an EM simulation, but we expect our microwave circuit simulation to be pretty good. In our microwave circuit simulation, we're not going to capture this effect. The idea is, do a design first of all, and if it's a critical design, which usually means you're going to sell a lot of parts, then just do an EM simulation to make sure that things are right. But there are some things we're not going to get in an EM simulation. These capacitors have a 3D nature. They're fairly high. We're not going to get the coupling from one side wall to the other right in a 2.5D simulation. And we're simply not going to do a 3D EM simulation because it takes far too long. So again, we have a line with a high characteristic impedance. We have a bank of capacitors. The output matching network we cannot use as simple a matching network, because from the transistor, looking into the drain of the transistor, we see an impedance of 2.5 minus J 11 ohms. And we need to go from this 2.5 ohms up to 50 ohms. We have a fairly low impedance transmission line. It's very wide. It won't be 2.5 ohms. We simply can't build that. The characteristic impedance of this line is possibly more like 10 ohms. Here we have a line which would have a little bit higher characteristic impedance. This is about lambda on 4 long. This is a little bit shorter, of course. This won't be exactly lambda on 4 because we're going to design it so that with this impedance transformer and this little bit of impedance transformer, we get to 50 ohms. Again, we have lots of ground plane. We have a DC blocking capacitor. Now down here, we have a line with a high characteristic impedance. One thing that is missing from this output matching network that we saw in the input matching network was the use of a series resistance here to provide some RF isolation. Now we have a current flow of about 100 milliamps. If we used a 500 ohm resistor here, we would have a full 50 volt drop across it, so we can't put a resistor here. In addition, 100 milliamp is a fair bit of current, so we need to make this line a little bit wider than we had with the input matching network. This line is an RF line. It is about lambda on 4 long at our operating frequency. And here is our bank of capacitors, selected much the same way as we did with our input matching network. We want to present an RF short circuit at this point, so that when we go along our lambda on 4 long line, we present an RF open at that point. But it won't be perfect. We need to include this in our RF design. Getting back to our input matching network, this is the microwave circuit that we need. So here is our input matching network. The transistor is here. Here is our resistor. Here is our high impedance line. Here we have the tab from our transistor. We have a T going off to our resistor. We go up here to our circuit model. Over here is our active device. There is a change in width of our lines. We need to use a microwave circuit model for that. Here is our 50 ohm line, and there is our T to our 500 ohm resistor. This in larger form on the next slide, so I won't talk much more about this, but let's get back to this layout. A 50 ohm line, a DC blocking capacitor, and a 50 ohm line. Very standard. Building this for a high volume application. The transistor vendor provides a transistor with internal matching. It won't be much use away from 3.4 to 3.8 gigahertz. The input matching network is simply wrong. But at 3.4 to 3.8 gigahertz, we can use it. Then we have our high impedance line and our bank of capacitors. Here is our input matching network, or part of the input matching network, in more detail. Here is our RF input. Here is a 50 ohm line, our DC blocking capacitor, another 50 ohm line, a T, which is connected to a 500 ohm resistor. And the model for this T, the code, the computer code, picks up the width of the connections so that we have a fairly accurate model for that T. And at 3.4 to 3.8 gigahertz, we really need to consider that extra capacitance and parasitic inductance associated with that T. Another 50 ohm line, and then a step in width as we connect to our transistor. So this 1 millimeter is the width of the tab. Remember, this is not the same transistor that I used for illustration purposes up front, that LDMOS transistor. This is a gallium nitride transistor, and the tab is a different width. This transmission line here includes the effect of the mounting connection, the mounting pad, and also the fact that our 500 ohm resistor actually has a finite length. Altogether, this really is the model of our 500 ohm resistor. And then below this is all of our bias circuitry. Getting a little bit more detail for our bias circuitry, we see that we have a step change in width. Here is our high impedance line. This would be as high impedance as we can reliably produce. With this particular substrate, we've determined that 0.254 millimeter width is about the narrowest width that we can get by with. So here is some more high impedance line, and here is a T going off to our first bias capacitor. some transmission line, a capacitor, we've modeled that as a lumped element capacitor, some transmission line, and a via. Via is typically cylindrical, and this is a better model than we can ever hope to get in a 2.5D EM simulation. We could do a little bit better than this model. Here we've modeled the capacitor as a lumped element, but the capacitor vendor will provide the S parameters for the capacitor. We could use an S parameter 2 port here. If we're at 5 GHz, we really need to start looking at the S parameters. If we had RF signal here, if our RF signal really did interact with this capacitor, then it is that much more important that we use the S parameters. Having said that, let's get back to our DC blocking capacitor. This is in the RF path. We probably would like to use the 2-port S parameters here. At 5 GHz, absolutely. 3.4 to 3.8 GHz, but we're right on the border as to whether we should or not. Okay, continuing on, below this point we have the rest of the BIOS circuitry, and we're just replicating this type of model for our various BIOS capacitors. Again, here is the full detail for our input matching network. It seems fairly laborious to lay this all out and use all of these elements, but this does not take long because you can cut and paste and copy a lot of the details here. But this level of model is essential when we're operating really above about a gigahertz. The higher we go in frequency, the more critical it is that we get this model right. We use a similar model for the output matching network.